All right, we're going to get started on this project. I had already primed these with a gray. I can't remember if I used household gray primer or gray sky. Probably just gray sky. After I sealed them and lightly sanded them, because I wasn't sure what I originally was going to paint on this. And, you know, I tried adding some colors in there and trying to visually see what I could see. But now that I know what I'm going to put on it, I'm going to completely change the color. But the gray is a great base coat for just about any color, especially if you want to paint red. Gray is the one color that will make that red a true color. So that's something to take into consideration when you're painting red, and you don't want to, sometimes red can take a few coats to get it where you want it, but if you undercoat it with gray, you're good to go then. Alright, so I am going to paint all my pieces here black, lamp black, inside out. I'm just going to use a large, this is a 1-inch filbert brush, this is so I won't get too many, shouldn't get too many brush strokes with a filbert. If I was using a flat, I would get a little bit more, it would leave more brush strokes in there. So we want to get two coats, front, back, and sides. So I'm going to have you go get that. We're going to come back and get ready to start on these. Okay, we've got all of our black paint on. So we're going to start stenciling on here. I want the background to be a little bit dressier. So I've got this Harlequin stencil. This is a Patricia Rawlinson stencil. And I love it because it looks aged and worn and has a lot of character to it. So I'm just going to lay this on here and get it where it looks pretty straight. Now, I've got tack it over and over on the back of this so it sticks on there. I've got a fingertip dauber here. And I've dampened it slightly in water. So I'm going to dip into some graphite and tap it off on my palette. I don't want a ton of paint on this sponge because I don't want it to bleed under. Okay, so I'm going to work it up in there good. Now I'm just going to start tapping this on here. And I don't mind if I don't get perfect coverage on here because I want it to look like a very worn background. I want it to look aged. Now, you could paint, instead of painting your coasters black or whatever surface you're painting on, you could paint it like a buttermilk or light buttermilk color. So if you painted it buttermilk, then you could use like light buttermilk for this Harlequin part here. I'm going to get this one done so you can see what the background's going to look like. And then I'll go off camera and finish all my other ones. Now, once you get your black paint on, if your coasters or any of your surfaces feel a little bit rough, just very lightly sand it and wipe off the dust. You can sand it with a brown paper sack or a really fine grit sanding pad. Okay, so this should just look like it's kind of faded into the background. So let's see how that turned out. Oh yeah, that looks good. I like that. Okay, so I am going to go finish up my other ones, and then we'll come back and start building on top of this. Alright, I have taped off on all of my coasters. It's about, I don't know, 1/4 inch all the way around it. I measured in with my compass and marked off 1/2 inch, and then I measured and marked 3/8 inch, and I taped on those lines. Now on my box itself, I've only taped this section. I'm going to put my trim in there and then see if I want to come back and add it around that neck as well, but right now I'm not planning on doing it on that neck. So we're going to use some metal powder here. This is silver metal powder. take some of my matte varnish. Now I'm going to take, just scoop some out with my palette knife. And add it to my varnish. And mix it in. These metal powders can be purchased at creativeartslifestyles.com. That is Patricia Rawlinson's website. This stuff is just beautiful. It's like molten. I don't know. I just love it. And she's got several different colors. Gold and copper and pewter. And all right, so I'm going to just clean my palette knife off here. You can see just on my palette knife how shiny that is. Alright, I'm going to cover this back up because I want to make sure that no moisture gets in that. Okay, and I'm going to take a makeup sponge. And I use these a lot. And I just keep cutting them down till there's hardly anything left of them. They just last a long time and they're great little sponges to have. So I just want this all along, camera here, all along the outside edge where I taped off. Our roses are going to go in the middle here. We want to do two coats of this, so by the time you get each one of these pieces with one coat on it, it'll be ready. It'll be dry and ready for its next coat. And I like taping off with Scotch tape because it gives you very, very clean lines. Just a straight up and down dabbing. Also, as I am painting these coasters, I've got this little scissor box that I'm going to paint the same design on as well. I've got a small pair of scissors that I use here a lot. And so I'm going to paint it up so I can hold my scissors in. I don't remember where I got that little scissor holder. But I think that either Bear With Us or Hopcraft, one of those two websites, has them. I don't know if they still have the small one. I have had this small one in my little painting stash for quite a few years. So I don't even know if you can still get the small one, but I know you can still get the bigger ones. I just cannot recall which website has those. So on this one, I'll probably, if I decide to do silver, I may just do it up here, just around that. But I'll do that with a small round brush. Make some room for this piece here. Actually painting this coaster set as a gift. Our neighbors are getting ready to move to a new home, and I want to give her something that she can have for a long time and remember her old neighbors. She likes palm trees. I actually painted her a mailbox with palm trees on it that she intends to take with her, but I want to do something a little bit more elegant for her. So that's what I intend to do with this. I paint coaster sets up for gifts a lot. Something quick that I can paint, and they don't take up a lot of room, so I can store them and have a gift ready when I need it. The other thing that I like to paint up for gifts for weddings is the wine bottle holders that I think it is also a Patricia Robinson holder, the one that I like to use. But I also have the ones that just fit over a bottle. But I like to paint those up and give them a bottle of wine, nice bottle of wine, and some glasses. I usually try to put it in a painted box that matches the design that I painted for them. Paint, you know. So I try to do it up pretty nice. Alright, I'm about to run out of paint here. It's a good thing, because my last one here. I think I've got enough paint in this sponge to finish it out. This stuff gives wonderful, wonderful coverage. So now I'm just going to start removing the tape. You get really nice clean lines with Scotch tape. Oh yeah, that looks really classy and elegant. I like that. So let's get it off of our coasters here. Bleed under with that, and I'm very surprised because I've never ever had that happen with Scotch tape before, ever. So I'm just going to go in with my black and touch up where I got that bleed under on there. So I'm going to go and get all the tape off of these and do any touching up that I feel like I need to do. And we're going to come back and get started on the pattern. Okay, we're going to get started on getting this rose painted now. I did want to point out that the background, after I got my rose painted on here, which I made it a little bit bigger than I intended, covers up a lot of the stenciling. So that's going to be definitely an option if you choose not to stencil, or you can just do a slip-slap method with the graphite in the background and, you know, create some of that texture in the background. You can leave the silver band off if you choose not to. I just thought that raised up the elegance level of this piece just a little bit. So we're going to start basing in the rose with Spice Pink, and I'm going to use an 8 flat. You can use whatever size you're comfortable for. When I get more towards the middle here, I'm going to go to a round brush. Now, as I paint, I want to keep each one of my sections painted individually. So when I come back with my second coat, I will do the same thing, and that way I can tell where my petals will need to be, and I can come back in with my graphite pencil and add them back in. But for now, I want to make sure I try and keep them as individual as possible. So I will show you what I mean by that. You want to try and keep your movement on your edges out here. Don't round them off or flatten them in any way, because your rose needs to have that little bit of movement. So that's what I mean by painting in each section. So each petal will be painted in all on its own, so we can tell exactly where that petal will lay. And if your paint is thick, or you don't feel like it's moving, or it's globbing up, or you're getting ridges, then just add a tiny bit of water on your brush and go and pick up some paint. Blend it in with the paint. You just want to thin it down just a little bit to make it where it flows nicely off of your brush. Okay, so each petal all on its own. To keep your movement going, just kind of wiggle your brush on that edge out there to give that little bit of ruffling on the edge. I'm going to change brushes real quick and go to this center area. So I've just switched to a 4-round brush. And I'm kind of more up on the toe with this, or the tip of this brush, not laying it flat. And you may think after you get it all painted in that I can't tell at all where my lines are. That's okay. If that is the case, then just go back with your pattern after you've gotten your second coat on and add those lines back in. Now, if you can't, it's better if you could use a light graphite, but if you cannot see your lines, I had a little bit too much paint there, so I just went and wiped it on my paper towel. If you can't see your lines with the light colored graphite, but after you get two coats on this, this pink will be pretty dark, so you should be able to see it. Then use a darker graphite, but then after you put the lines on, go and erase them back so that you can barely see them. This is the bowl down here. We have this one petal that is attached right here, and it is folded, pulled away from the rose, and it's folded itself up and flipped itself a little bit. So that's what that petal is, if you're wondering what that is that I drew on there. Okay, now while we have this, we can go up here and do the buds as well. We want to try and keep them, the petals on it, as individual as we can. I'm painting this from a photograph, so it's not exactly, every detail won't be exactly like the photograph, but it is my inspiration, so. Okay, that's how we're going to do the painting of the rose. So I'm going to get this dry and get my second coat on. Well, I tell you what, before I go do second coats, let's go ahead and put some first coats on the leaves. I want to paint the calyx with Hauser Light Green. So we've got a calyx here, and a calyx here, and then these all on the buds up here. Okay, so we're going to paint them all. I'm just using this 4-round brush. They'll all be based in with Hauser Light Green. Calyx have some kind of pointy edges to them. So when we come back and add detail to it, if you lose that, then we can come back in and add it back in. Here to this one so you can see where it's at. Coming off. I'm also going to paint the stem this color. Calyx are very, they have a very defined point at the end of them. So, if you didn't draw a good point on there, just bring it out with the tip of your brush and create that nice point on that calyx. Pull the stem down. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and show you what color I'm going to base coat the leaves in. I'm going to use let's see, avocado or light avocado. I think I will use avocado because rose leaves are a little bit darker. So I'm going to use my flat brush on these. Now this is just my rough drawing on here, so I don't have a lot of detail on my leaves, but these leaves, I'm just wiggling the brush back and forth like I'm scrubbing and moving it along as I go. These leaves have a lot of points on the edges of them. Now don't lose that wiggle shape of your rose there. Now, this right here, you can see where the graphite line is showing through the paint because I painted over it. So you have to make sure that if you paint over a graphite line, you put enough paint on it to cover it. We're going to be doing a lot of layering on these roses, adding some lighter colors to the edges and things like that, so I won't have a problem with covering that. But once you put paint on it, even if there is a little bit of paint in your water, and you rinse your brush out and you just apply water to your painting and you go over a graphite line, well, there's paint, a little bit of paint in that water, and it can set that graphite line. So once you've painted over it with any kind of paint, it's not going to come off. So just be aware that it will become part of your piece. Just wiggling that brush back and forth to get those points on the edge. It's like a sawing motion, back and forth. If you have ever painted one-stroke leaves, this is similar to, by one-stroke I mean the Donna Dewberry one-stroke technique. This is very similar to her technique. I am certified in one-stroke, and it does come in handy being able to use that technique every now and then. Learning how to use your brush through the way that she paints really does teach you a lot. Teaches you a lot of control over your brush. Okay, so we're going to base all the leaves in with that color. So I'm going to get all my base coats on and get my second layer of base coats on, and any detail lines that I feel like I need to add back in, I'm going to do that, and then we'll come back and get started. Alright, I went ahead and drew my lines back on so that you could see how the center of this flower is going. So we are going to get started and do some shading on here. We are going to start with Cad Red first. And I am going to use a 10 curved flat. You can use an angle brush, whatever you are comfortable using. I've got Cad Red and Alizarin Crimson on my palette here. Now I'm going to spray the edge of my palette with water so that I have water drops. As you're floating, you will need water. So I will go over here on the curved side, or if you're using an angle brush, on the angle side or the heel side of your brush and pick up water. You only want to pick it up on the toe if your paint is extremely dry. And then to load my brush, I dip the toe, or the corner of this brush, into the paint, and I work it in a V. And I like to get it over, your first float will be the widest, your first shading will be the widest, and then your second one will be not quite as wide. So I am working the paint over the brush, over this way, and up the brush. So I'm going to push a little bit harder to get that paint up in the brush, but not so hard that it covers every bit of my brush. So you see I've got a nice shading of color right there, and that's how it's going to look when you go to paint with it. Floating just takes a little bit of practice of loading your brush. Another thing that you might want to remember when floating is unless you're in a really tight place, which on this we will have a lot of tight places, you want to try and lay your brush flat and apply soft pressure. Now I'm just kind of walking that out a little bit. I always use a mop brush when I float, and I mop in the water edge. I only go into the paint edge if I need to remove some paint. If you go into the paint, that's exactly what you will do. You will remove it. So we're going to go, I'm going to stay with this brush as long as I can. I will eventually need to go to a smaller brush. I'm kind of more up on the toe here, kind of over on the angle, because that was a little tight area right there. Okay, I'm loading some more underneath here. Okay, I'm going to go under this petal that is laying over this one. Put some here. And under. That's a petal there, probably connected to this petal. And we need a dark up and under here, so I'm up on the toe. Okay, I need a little bit of water. The paint was not wanting to move on my brush. Okay, I'm going to go to a smaller curved flat now. Well, before I do that, I need to do this one, this petal over here. This pencil that I'm using is just a dressmaker's pencil. I got it at Joann's. It comes with green, pink, and white lead. I love using this when I'm drawing my patterns on, if I'm just freehanding it, because it erases with paint or water, so it doesn't get set in your paint like a graphite pencil or when you use transfer paper. Okay, now I'm going to go to a smaller curved flat. If you were doing these areas, you would have, with an angle brush, you could have used a 3/8 angle, and now you would go down to a 1/4 inch. So I'm down to a 6 curved flat now. Loading it the same way, just on that toe, pushing it up the brush so I have more paint to carry where I want to go. I'm laying the brush flat and soft pressure. Okay, I walked it out just a little bit. Now I'm mopping. More up on the toe here. Very center is going to be the darkest area right there. Okay, I want to put just, let me go around this corner here first. I want to put a little bit of shading right here on this edge, but not too much because it's going to be mostly highlight on this one. Okay, now let's go up to the buds. I'm still staying with this smaller curved flat. I didn't draw my pattern lines on here, so some darker color down here around these calyx. Okay, I think this one right here, actually I'll stay with the 6 curve flat. Bring that shading out just a little bit more. So I'm just kind of tap walking. Okay, I need to adjust the edge of this bowl right here, because it will be more rounded. It won't be quite that flat. Okay, now let's go into some alizarin crimson. So this float, I'm going back to the bigger curved flat here. This float won't be quite as wide out, so I won't walk it out. I'm just going to float it in here and then gently mop it. Same here. I'm going to be up on the toe a little bit right there. I'm going to keep this a little more controlled on the floating. Now this one, the original float on this petal, I can see I did not come out far enough. So I'm going to wash my brush and go back into the cad red. This needs to come out quite a bit farther on this petal. As well as down here needs to come out a little bit more. This leaf right here has a fold in it right there and right here. So it will be darker in those places. Okay, let me go back to my alizarin crimson. I think this one is dry, so I can continue with this larger brush. I like using the curved flats because now, see, I'm up on the toe a little bit here. So I have a little tighter area. So I'm just soft pressure, laying the brush flat. Okay, gently mop that. Okay, I'm going to go to my smaller brush now. The reason I like using the curved flats is because I just think they work wonderful for floating. They give you such soft floats. So give it a try. If you've got a coupon for Michaels and they still carry them, our Michaels was clearancing out a lot of little Cornell brushes the other day, so I don't know if they're going to continue to carry them or not. Give them a try. I think that you will like them. We're keeping this a lot smaller float, so stay up on your toe in these really tight areas. Okay. Now I want to create some really deep, dark, shaded areas in here. And so I'm going to take the alizarin crimson and a tiny, tiny touch of black and mix them together. I want to make almost like a cranberry wine color, but I don't want you to have to get another color out. So I just mixed a tiny bit of black in there with that. Okay, so we want to go, I'm still using my 6 curve flat, my small one. I'm going to wipe a little bit of that paint off. I want to go into some of these darker places. When I'm touching that with my finger, I'm just blending, just pulling the paint out and blending it. Here's going to be really, really dark right here. Almost too fold over. Right here. It's going to be a little bit darker right there. Oops, I've got just a tad bit too much black on my brush, so let me go re-blend. Okay, let's go up here to the buds and add some of this darker color in here. Alright, one more place on here, and then we're going to start doing just a tiny bit of highlighting. Too much black, so I wiped it off. I'm reloading. Okay, let's leave the shading there for now. One thing I didn't tell you was how to clean your mop brush. You want to go to a clean, wet place on your paper towel and wipe the paint out, and then go to a dry, clean place on your paper towel and dry it off, and it's good to go. If you put it in water, you'll have to wait for it to dry or have another one available. So you don't usually get a lot of paint built up in it, but the tips of it will get paint on it, so you want to try and clean it as you go. It's very, very easy to clean. All right, let's start some highlighting. So we're going to take our base color, which was Spice Pink, and we're going to mix it with some pink chiffon. So I am going to just brush mix this. It's going to be equal amounts. So I dip my toe of my brush into this one, then I dip into this one. And I just go back and forth until I've got my brush loaded the way that I want it to be loaded. So I've got a lighter shade of pink there. We want to build our highlights up. So we're going to go on the outer edge here. Now I'm going to have some like little valley places in this leaf. So I'm just going to put this, I'm just using the water edge to soften that. I want the highlight on this to be up here mostly. on the folded part because that's the part that will be catching the light. I'm using my tin, curved flat. You can go to a smaller brush. Make sure you keep that movement going on your petals. Don't make them flat or clean that up right there where I got into my shading color. So I could go down to a smaller curved flat. It would probably be a little bit easier. I think if you can learn to use bigger brushes and have control over those bigger brushes, you learn to paint a little bit better because you've learned to how to control your brush. And I just kind of dab that on there. Okay, now this one down here, we're gonna have a little highlight on this edge. I'm going to go to a smaller brush to get these smaller, down to my 6 curve flat. Not too much water in my brush, it's thinning my paint. Let me try that again. Don't want to cover up your shading, so try to be aware of your brush. I'm kind of staying up on the tip of it a little bit more. Now right here in the center, I'm going to be straight up on that tip. Okay, and this. Pull that out into the center there. That cup right there. Need just a little bit more distinction on the edge of this one. I'll probably have to come back in and reshade right there. Okay, so let's do a little bit on the buds. And highlighting your layering of colors is so important when you're painting like this, because as you build each layer and each color, you get more and more depth in your design. Okay, I want to add some shaded or some like folded areas. So I'm going to go back to the cad red, my small curved flat. And I just want to create a couple of like valleys. It's like a little V right there. And I think I'll put another one. Right there. Okay, let's go over to this one and add maybe a couple to it. So I'm just pulling a little V down in there. We'll come back and add some more highlighting in there. Okay, and then this one up here, I think needs a little bit. Okay, let's go back with some more highlighting. This time I'm going to go, do just straight pink chiffon. So as you build your highlights and shades, you get a little bit smaller with each one. Bring that down in that where that V is just a little bit. That might be just a little bit too stark of a on the line, so let me just take a damp brush and erase that. I'll come back with my shading, I think, and fix that a little bit more. Needs to get a little deeper shading in there. So this is just my second highlight, and I'm just doing kind of a hit and miss on the edges there. Paint was dragging right there, so I needed more water on my brush. So this one here, I'm going to brush a little bit of that across there, and then I just use my finger to soften that. I want to put a little bit on this edge. Not a lot. Do this one out here. Do that little bit of wiggling as you paint so you don't get straight edges there. Okay, up here on the bud. Next step for highlighting is warm white, but before I do that, I'm going to go into my alizarin crimson and a little bit of that down in there. Any place that I feel like I've lost a little bit of my shading by putting that highlight on there. I'm really up on the toe of this brush. Okay, I'm going to mix a little bit more of that alizarin crimson with the black. I need to intensify my shading just a little bit. Right my small curved flat still. Center here. We need a little bit of this. Definitely need more water there. So I basically just redid the whole shading with a second layer of that black. Black and alizarin crimson mixture. Okay, now we want to come back and do some warm white for our highlights. Now I'm going to stay with my 6 curved flat until I get to the very center, and then I'm going to switch over to either a liner or a small round brush to get some of those tighter highlights in there. This is an even smaller, tighter highlight than we just did. I'm just kind of skimming it. This one I can still use this brush on. Alright, I'm going to switch over to a number one round. You could go with a liner brush if you want. I'm still just kind of skimming over this. Not putting hardly any pressure on the brush. Tapping in where I think I need it to be just a little bit brighter. We're going to glaze over this here in a minute. Basically just a dibby-dabby tap kind of thing. Okay, I want to glaze over this whole rose right here. Before I do that, I can see right here, I kind of lost my definition of lines right there. So I just quickly went over that with my alizarin crimson so I could get those those lines in there. I want to glaze over this with some dragon fruit. So we're just going to make a glaze, and to do that, you can use whatever brush you're comfortable using. I've got an 8-flat here. So I've got water in my brush, so I'm going to pull some of this paint out, and I'm just going to really thin it down with water. It's going to be mostly water, not very much paint. Just getting another little drip of water there. Okay, we're just going to glaze my brush there. Glaze over this. I want this rose to be more on the pink side. This will not cover up our highlights, but they'll still remain highlights. Buds too. Okay, I'm going to let that rose rest for just a little bit. I want to go work on the leaves. So I will come back to that rose and add a little bit to that. Alright, on the leaves we're going to start with some black green for shading. So load your brush like I showed you earlier. Put it on the toe. Work it up. Brush. We're going to start shading back here. Just kind of walk that out a little bit. Just a tiny bit too much water on my brush there. Water on that one. Something. They're all going to get this color at the base. We will have to repeat this twice, and the second time I may add a tiny bit of black to it to just darken that up a little bit. I'm going to work on just the leaves for now. I will work on the calyx after I get the leaves done. So I want to repeat that. I'm going to see how it looks with just straight black green. I may want to add a little bit of black in it. That looks pretty good. Paint on the wrong edge of my brush, so I had to wash it off real quick. I think what I will do, so you don't have to watch me paint every single one of these leaves, I'm going to finish a couple out for you. So like this one and this one. And then you can use that same technique to finish out the rest of the leaves. So I want to create a vein in the center. So I'm going to float down one edge. Let me do this one. Okay, then I want to leave a gap and go down this side. Have them meet at the tip there. Okay, I'm going to go to my 6 curved flat because I want to create some veins in these. Okay, you see how dirty my mop brush is? I'm going to go clean that real quick. Damp, clean, damp place, dry place. Clean it out. Okay, a smaller curved flat or angle brush, whichever you're using. You like to do this with a flat brush, you can also do that. So I'm going to create some veins coming off of these leaves. Okay, so I want to shade like underneath where I put every one of those lines. We're going to come back and highlight in between them, so you want to keep your shading fairly tight. So kind of stay up on the edge of it. The toe of it, I guess. That brush. Smaller brushes, you always have to go back and load more frequently, so they just don't carry as much paint. Much easier if you can pull toward yourself. Now we want to take some Hauser light green. First off, I'm going to erase my lines on here because they get distracting. Okay, I'm going to take my I've got my 6 curved flat. I'll see how that does. I might want to switch over to my bigger one. Actually, instead of my curved flat, I'm going to use my flat brush because I can get a better chisel point on that. So I'm just going to load one toe of this brush. Okay. Just work that paint up on the brush a little bit. And we want to create our points. Not going to see too well until I can. So it's again, it's just that sawing motion. Okay, just soften that back a little bit. I'm going to take the damp side of my brush and gently soften that. Need to have a good flat brush in order to do this. So you can have that nice chisel edge to get that nice point. Okay, water edge. Soften that a little bit. going to repeat that, but not with that color. I want to take a small round brush right now and load it with some of that Hauser light green. We're just going to kind of drag some of this in between our veins here. It's just a light touch. Just kind of letting the paint come off of there as it wants to come off. Okay. Now I want to get a little bit of jade green. Before I go on to the jade green, I'm going to take a liner brush. I like to use a 10-0 liner. And with that Hauser light green, I'm going to not have hardly any on my brush if I can. Go down the center vein and try to highlight the tops of these veins a little bit. Giving a light touch, just kind of dragging that on there. Okay, now I want to go to the jade green. Intensify just on the very tips. Not down the whole side, just on the very tips. Okay, I'm going to take a little bit of black. Not black green, avocado, I believe, is what we base these leaves with. And I just want to stay with that round brush. I don't want quite so stark of a line right there. Kind of blend that back in there. This one looks all right, but this one was getting kind of a hard line there. Okay, now I want to take my liner brush, my 10-0 liner, and go into some of that jade green. And I just want to do down the very middle of that, maybe just a dot or two here and there on those veins. Don't have to do every one of them. Now we want to take some cad red. I'm going to use my 6 curved flat. You'll have to do this a couple of times. So I want to put some red tints on my leaves. And you can pick and choose which leaves and where at on your leaves. Does not have to be every leaf. It's definitely a judgment call there. Creative license. Whatever you want to do. Or you can just follow my design here and do exactly like I am doing. Okay. So I'm going to go finish up the other leaves and then we'll come back and work on the calyx. I wanted to show you something as I was going around doing these leaves. I decided on my first highlight on the edges, instead of going straight Hauser light green, I added a little, tiny little bit of avocado in there, which is our leaf base color on these leaves, and I like how that looks a lot better. So that is something that you'll want to keep in mind when you are doing yours. I think I might go over this one and redo it. Okay, I've got my leaves done. So now I'm going to create a glaze of black green. Just like we did with that dragon fruit. And I'm going to brush this glaze over each one of these leaves. Because rose leaves are pretty dark leaves. Will remain. Okay, those are pretty good. Now let's move on to our calyx. We're going to go with the black green and a small curved flat, number 6 or a quarter inch angle brush. Start shading the base of these. Forget the stem. This is just a tapping of color. I'm going to put a little bit of green up on the rose itself. Then I want to come up on the chisel edge of the brush and just streak some of this darker color down through that. Okay, you can also, if you want to, I think on my original one I did do this. Very tight down each edge of that. Give that little look of roundness. Okay, now we want to go into some, let's see, we're going to go into jade green. Edges of the calyx with this jade green. I'm going to keep that nice sharp point on the top of those calyx. We're going to deepen that shading, that black-green shading, just a little bit. It needs to be. All got out of line there, so I just took a damp brush and cleaned that up. This is jade green, just kind of tapping it on the tips of this. Okay, now I want to streak a little bit of this down that stem. Go back to our black green because we want to intensify that shading. Just tapping it in there, keeping it a little irregular. A little bit of this green onto the buds. You could probably go with avocado if you wanted to do that. So let me go with a little bit of avocado here. Buds haven't quite turned yet. Okay, now we want to get some bright yellow. We're going to put this on the tips of the calyx. See how that just brightens those up. We are also going to add some washes of this yellow onto the rose. So just some random places. You can pick and choose where you want it to go, but we want to carry that color into the rose. Okay. Now I'm going to set back a bit and look at this. And I can already tell that I need a little bit brighter. So I'm going to go into my warm white. Too much water on my brush here. Put these highlights back on. I just think it needs those brighter little. It needed that glazing of that pink on there, but down our highlights just a little bit too far. Bit more of that yellow on there. this rose might be done. Okay. I think we've got a completed rose. Thanks for painting with me. Well, I thought it was completed, but I was wrong. We have one more step we have to do to the calyx. They need some of that cad red on them as well. And this is just a little dabbing. Definitely irregular. Nothing perfect about this. Just dab it on there. You could also, if you wanted, put a thorn on your okay. Yep, they definitely needed that. Okay, now we've got a completed project. Thanks again.